Very warm welcome to everyone. Good evening. Thank you for tuning in with us for yet another Friday lecture. Like each Friday, we bring to you a new speaker and a new topic with diverse domains and areas of research. So today, I'm very grateful to have Professor Gregory with us. So, sir, thank you so much for accepting our invitation on behalf of Professor Sangeeta Menon and also on behalf of Team CSP. I'll request Meera Kumar Menon to please introduce the speaker of today. Over to you, Meera.
Yeah. Thank you, Niharika, and welcome, Professor Gregory, sir. Dr. S. Gregory is presently the chairman for the Board of Studies in Anthropology, Kannur University. He was formerly the Dean of the Faculty of Social Sciences and the Director for the School of Distance Education. He has worked as the Head of Department of Anthropology and was a member of the Academic Council and Statutory Finance Committee, Coordinator at RUSA and Chairman for the Board of Studies in Anthropology. He has also served as the Advisor for Union Public Service Commission and was a member of the UGC Expert Committee in Anthropology. Dr. S. Gregory was awarded the prestigious Fulbright Nehru Visiting Lecture Fellowship in the year 2011-12. His research interests include sustainable development, livelihood and social change, participatory research, travel, development and health culture, to name a few. It is indeed an honor to have you, sir. So we request you to please.
Thank you very much, Meera, for your brief introduction. And good evening to all, one and all. And in fact, I'm very happy to be here as part of NIA's Friday lecture series to talk on eco-aesthetics, indigenous culture and development. I always enjoy to be with NIA's and take part in its activities. And thank you very much. And let us begin with the talk. Let me start with the term aesthetics. Aesthetics has been subjected to philosophical discourse since ancient times. And its nature has been expounded differently by different scholars. In most discourses, the close association between nature and aesthetics has been obvious, though there may be differences in the details of its manifestation. Since the tribes have been known for their symbiotic relationship with nature, in their traditions and culture, aesthetics, with reference to the tribal people and their expressive culture, has a special significance and relevance, particularly in understanding the development discourse of today. My attempt here would be to first analyze the discourse on the understanding of aesthetics and nature and relate this with the historical perception and representation of the native cultures. This would be followed by an overview of some of the features of expressive cultures of the Adivasis having a symbiotic relationship with nature and an appraisal of the appropriate tribal development approach in the process of their contact with the mainstream society. Let me begin with the term aesthetics. The term aesthetics essentially concerns with the nature of beauty, which can be understood as anything that is pleasing, anything that is good, healthy, or desirable. However, the question arises as to the nature of its essence and existence. Does aesthetics have an objective existence? Should what is pleasing to one necessarily be creating the same feeling in all others too? Is there anything inherent in an object that creates happiness in all human beings? And if so, is it universal? Or is it only a mental construction? And if it is only a mental construction, is a perception of aesthetics only from an aesthetic mode? And so only relative. From the Platonian point of view, the objects in the physical world are only mere representation of the real and perfect, of the ideal world. And so the objects themselves are not real or perfect. Accordingly, the reality consists of archetypes, forms, and models of all human experience, which is only the imitations of the real forms. While the artist's work is considered as an imitation of an imitation, Aristotle believed that happiness is the aim of life. For both Aristotle and Plato, aesthetics is inseparable from morality and politics. Plotinus goes to the extent of saying that aesthetic experience comes closest to mystical experience because one loses oneself while contemplating the aesthetic object. According to the German philosopher Johann Gottlieb Fichte, beauty is a moral virtue. Immanuel Kant was concerned with judgments of taste. When the objects satisfy a disinterested desire, free of personal interests or needs, they can be judged beautiful. Thus, according to Kant, beautiful objects have no specific purpose, and that judgments of beauty are not expressions of mere personal preference, but are universal. The basis for one's response to beauty, therefore, according to Immanuel Kant, exists in the structure of one's mind. In his view, judgments might be reconciled or aesthetic valuations harmonized through the appeal to a realm of shared appreciation beyond the mere boundaries of individual taste. Art is compared to natural beauty in giving the same disinterested and objectified satisfaction. According to Hegel, beauty in nature is everything that the human spirit finds pleasing and congenial to the exercise of spiritual and intellectual freedom. In short, aesthetics in its essence is inherent in reality, while the perception of it is very much partial, depending on the maturity of the individuals to realize its potentiality in a given context. The aim of life should be towards realizing the essence of aesthetics, though the totality of which is never fully perceived or experienced. Thus, the perception of aesthetics is relative, while its essence is absolute. It is not possible to speak of pure perception untouched by our experiences, education, and training, and uninfluenced by our ideas and other kinds of knowledge, as perception is profoundly influenced by culture. With reference to our empirical reality, we can find nature as the best definition of aesthetics. And therefore, the term eco-aesthetics, or what we call environmental aesthetics. In a broader sense, eco-aesthetics concerns the aesthetic appreciation of the world in its entirety, including both the natural and the built environments, and is consequently the broadest category of aesthetics. According to the biblical story of creation, after each day of creation, God looks at everything and becomes pleased with his creation. Lastly, he also creates Adam and Eve, the first of all the tribal people, giving them the freedom to enjoy the innocence and beauty of the uncorrupted light of nature. It brings out very clearly the idea that nature is good and beautiful and yields the feeling of good, and the oneness with nature leads to eternal bliss. Our perception becomes corrupted only when the extraneous intervention of lust and ambition gets injected in the minds of the pristine pure Adam and Eve, forcing them to revolt against the will of God by yielding to the vices and thus going against nature. The result is that God sends the humans out of Eden, but it is only to make themselves adaptable with their own creative capabilities and capacities and experience the pleasures of a wider environment, which would include their own creation in the form of culture. Thus, environment in its wider sense could refer to the entire universe, while in a narrow sense, it could be all that is within one's perception and experience, and so varying from one person to the other. Again, environment in its narrow sense would refer only to the nature alone, while in the wider sense, it also includes what is not natural, but has been adapted in the form of culture. Culture comes to exist through the creative efforts of humans to realize the potentiality of nature and becomes part of the larger environment, as long as it does not exceed the limits of nature, or in other words, as long as it does not go against the precepts of nature. The tribal people who are identified in different names, such as the natives, the indigenous people, the autochthons, aboriginals, Adivasis, or original inhabitants, are known for their closeness to natural environment. Indigenous societies world over, in their traditional way of life, manifest a closer affinity to and maintain a symbiotic relationship with nature, as reflected in their worldviews and cultural system. They have a great emotional attachment to their lands and forests. In their traditional cultural framework, these were considered as nature's gifts, similar to air and water. To a majority of the tribal people, their very livelihood and existence depend on the forest. Their very identity springs out of their deep-rooted relationship with nature. For the same reason, the eco-aesthetics is highly discerned in the life of the native population. However, they have been perceived by the people of the advanced societies differently since long. Bernier Elwin, a missionary turned tribal protagonist, who is also one of the foremost in dealing with the affairs of the tribal people in the post-independent India, captures the questions that have agitated in the minds of the people for several hundreds of years before the present. What is the question? Is man better in a state of nature or of art? Again, is the untutored savage happier, more moral, in a word, better than the sophisticated and urban product of the modern world? Elwin feels that there are, and there have always been, people who consider that the primitive folk are better than we are, and are therefore better off as they are. For the same reason, such people, according to Elwin, would like to segregate the natives from the contaminating influence of the so-called civilization, and would protect them not only economically, but culturally from outside exploitation. As Elwin further notes, James Boswell's encounter with Rousseau convinces Boswell to be all for the noble savages and argues for their superior happiness, while Samuel Johnson looks down on them. According to Elwin, it was already with the discovery of the New World, with its exciting populations of the primitive people, that hot debates and serious discussion about the natives assumed significance. Elwin refers to Michel de Montaigne as opining that the inhabitants of the unpolluted and harmless world of the hills and forests were naturally virtuous as compared to the civilized man, the so-called civilized man. In the perception of Montaigne, according to Elwin, the native Indians are wild, like the wild flowers, but in them are the true and most profitable virtues and natural properties, most lively and vigorous, which have become bastardized by civilization, applying them to the pleasures of the corrupted taste of the so-called civilized. Again, according to Elwin, Herbert Spencer identifies gentle nobility in the tribesmen, while there are others who perceive them as knowing no other wealth but peace and pleasure, while deploring the corrupting influence of the early colonists and planters. Thomas Fuller seems to have spoken of the Christian savages going to convert the so-called savages. There are also others who seem to have portrayed these people as human beasts and inhuman savages.
So, excuse me, just a second. Yes. So, completely audible. Your voice is breaking a little bit here and there. Yeah. Would it be able to check the speakers or the Wi-Fi?
Do you hear me now?
Yeah. No. Yes. Yes. Yes.
You can hear me. Okay. Okay.
Yes. Thank you, sir. Please continue.
Okay. Elwin also talks of Shakespeare personifying the diverging views more effectively in his The Tempest through the characters of Caliban, an aboriginal of the New World, and Prospero representing the colonist or planter. The latter takes over the territory of the farmer and reduces him to a mere slave and woodcutter, even while providing him with social uplift and education. Elwin refers to Frank Kermode as perceiving Caliban's education not only useless but harmful, creating in him lust, discontent at his inferior position, ambition, incompetence of all kinds, including disposition to enslave himself to the bottle of Stefano. Elwin rightly acknowledges that such is a very common result, even today, of a too rapid acculturation. Shakespeare's portrayal of Caliban also brings out the virtues in him, his ear for music, his command for poetry, and his words of sublime beauty, and how he has been wrong, while Elwin does not fail to point out the vices of civilization in Shakespeare portraying its representatives in their way and behavior, being not better than Caliban himself, the drunken buffoons, the malicious degenerate, and the guilty stained, under whose influence Caliban takes to drink and turns treacherously upon his master. In the view of Elwin, Shakespeare seems to portray the primitive man as not much good, while contact with civilization would only make him worse. In Elwin's view, the 17th century witnesses a widespread sentiment in favor of the natives. With the increasing idealization of nature and the country life, where humans could commune with God and where the purest virtues could be practiced. On the other hand, the course of history is supposed to be steadily downhill, with the civilization seen as a steady corruption of what had originally been perfect, logically leading to Rousseau's back to nature movement in the following century. Thus, Elwin points out that primitivism, both cultural and chronological, had been seen as better than civilization, leading to an increasing interest in primitive peoples. Elwin refers to a poem of an earlier period by Aphra Behn, personifying the erotic freedom, lack of inhibitions, and the sexual innocence of the soft primitives prior to their corruption by modern society. The poem goes like this: in that blessed golden age, when man was young, when the whole race was vigorous and strong, when nature did her wondrous dictates give and taught the noble savage how to live. In the following century, as Elwin portrays, with the coming of European imperialism and with the great expansion of missionary movement, colonists and missionaries alike had to justify their existence by showing their necessity to the hidden world, which need to be saved from the suffering of original sin. In this context, Elwin aptly presents the remarks of Voyager Captain Cook, who seems to have stated, "The savages of Australia may indeed appear to be the most wretched people upon earth, but in reality, they are far more happy than we Europeans, being wholly unacquainted not only with the superfluous, but with the necessary conveniences so much sought after in Europe. They are happy in not knowing the use of them." The modern intruders, according to Elwin, were personified as playing the part of the serpent in the New Eden, with a cross in one hand and a gun in the other to enslave the bodies and poison the minds of the natural man, who finds himself at odds with the artificial man. It was perfectly fitting into the philosophy that the child is happier than man. Accordingly, the best thing that was expected of the modern man was to leave him alone. The indigenous population is said to be about 476 billion all over the world today, dispersed in more than 90 countries, making up over 6% of the global population. More than one-fifth of them are in India, who constitute more than 8% of India's population. Although there are 705 officially recognized ethnic groups, there are many more ethnic groups that would qualify for the scheduled tribe status, but which are not officially recognized. However, it may not be accurate to equate the lifestyle of all those who bear the name of tribes today with the typical tribal way of life that is referred here, as the tribes today are at different levels of integration with the mainstream. However, there are a few tribes who still possess something of their pristine past and are still not so much contaminated by the external influences. The tribal people who are still untouched by the modern civilization are traditionally said to be the of subsistence type, with simple technology that fits well with their ecological surroundings and conservative outlook. Accumulation and profit making, that are the characteristic features of modern economy, which is basically market oriented, are totally unknown to the tribal economy. While cooperation, reciprocity, and collective endeavor form the base of their economy, which is essentially forest-based, with the flora and fauna of the forest dominating the primary sources of their livelihood. LP Vidyarthi and BK Roy identify 5 important factors, namely natural environment, population, human being, material technology, and social environment as forming the matrix of social life of the tribal people, of which natural environment is often conceived as the basic, as all societies depend on it for the basic needs such as food, fuel, shelter, etc. This closeness to nature gets reflected in every aspect of their life. The land on which they live and the natural resources on which they depend are inextricably linked to their identities, cultures, livelihoods, as well as their physical and spiritual well-being. The social divisions as clan are generally associated with a definite group of individuals set in certain mysterious relation to an animal, a plant, an object, animate or inanimate, in the form of totems, after which they are named and in connection with which marital ties are regulated. The object with which the group is named must be respected. The tribal people also have clearly demarcated territorial boundaries at different levels of social divisions and regulated under the corresponding authority and leadership. Tribal religion has long been described as animistic. Animals, plants, trees, rivers, stones, hills, or mountains are all abodes of spirits. The whole neighborhood, whether village or forest, in which the tribal people live is considered to be full of spirits. Worship of nature or nature worship is another form of belief which prevails among the tribal people. The sun, the moon, and the earth are considered the creator or supreme power. Every religious festival includes appropriate dances, songs, and stories reflecting the mythology of the people. The beating of drums and blowing of flutes, dancing to the tunes, folk tales, and folk songs form the core of the tribal art, music, and dance as a whole. Their wood carvings and paintings symbolize their life and beliefs. Their artistic performances reflect hunting, agriculture, and other such activities of their everyday lives, expressing the inner feelings and presenting a vivid picture of tribal life. It is this pristine culture which had been in perfect symbiosis with nature for several centuries that have been allowed to become corrupt in our over-enthusiasm to maintain and mainstream their life. The tribes who are champions of such culture have been allowed to become totally alienated from their treasured tradition without gaining anything, throwing to the winds the romantic concept of the noble savages, the idealized picture of nature's gentleman conceived by Rousseau as early as in the 18th century, or Elwin's concerns expressed towards the end of the colonial era, or the wisdom manifested by Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru with regard to the natives at the dawn of the independent India. Today, there are very few who have escaped from such alienation and corruption, and who continue to sustain in the company of nature's beauty and pristine culture. One of the objectives of tribal development is to bring the tribes to become part of the mainstream. In the context of the tribal people, there had been three dominant approaches that had been invoked in this regard. There had been scholars like G.S. Gurye and A.V. Thakur, who strongly felt that the tribal people need to be assimilated into the Indian culture. There were others like Barry Irving and J.H. Hutton, who had strong reservations with such an approach, as they witnessed unhealthy consequences to the tribal culture and way of life. Hence, they advocated isolationist approach with intention to avoid unregulated culture contact and cultural suicide. The third one is the integrationist approach. The assimilationist approach had never been an anthropological approach, as it implied the submerging of one culture under the domination of another culture. As for the other two approaches, the integrationist approach had been accepted as ideal in ideal circumstances, while isolationism had been advocated in the past in special and specific circumstances. The post-independent approach towards the tribes under the strong influence of Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru had been clearly in favor of integration. By integrationism, Jawaharlal Nehru basically meant bringing together the people of different cultural identities without compromising the uniqueness of respective identities. Nehru held a respect and love for the tribal people. Though he was doubtful whether the tribal or modern way of living is better, he declared that he was quite certain that in some respects, theirs is better. He said, "I felt happy with these simple folk because the nomad in me found congenial soil in their company." He was alarmed, he said, when he saw not only in this country, but in other countries too, how anxious people are to shape others according to their own image or likeness and impose them their particular way of living. He also prescribed a panchsheel for tribal welfare. The Nehruvian principle clearly underlined the importance of developing the tribal people along the lines of their own genius without any kind of imposition whatsoever. His principle also emphasizes the tribal rights in land and forest, self-administration, the necessity of working through their own social and cultural institutions to the extent possible, and all welfare efforts aiming at change should be measured in terms of their quality of life. According to Jawaharlal Nehru, what we ought to do was to develop a sense of oneness with the natives and approach them with affection and understanding. For Nehru, an officer in tribal areas should not merely be a man who has passed an examination or gained experience of routine work, but a man with enthusiasm, whose mind and ever even more so, whose heart understands the problem that he had to deal with. He even went to the extent of saying that it was far better to send a totally uneducated man to a tribal area, so long as he or she lived with the people with friendship and affection and produce better results than a brilliant intellectual who would curse his fate of having been posted in a tribal area. That was the spirit of his policy of integration. So for the integrationist approach to work in an ideal way, it has to essentially be accompanied along with the five principles that Nehru had advocated. Marian Alvin, who was then the advisor to the tribal policies of the government, was one of those who had strongly been advocating the integrationist approach in the fresh and changed environment of the independent India. It was the same Elvin who had also been accused many times as the main advocate of the isolationist approach, though he himself had time and again clarified about his earlier and qualified stand and the rationale behind such position. Elvin rightly emphasized that the approach to the tribal welfare is aimed not merely at the socio-economic upliftment of tribal people, but most importantly, in restoring to them the liberties of their own countryside. The great problem he realized was how to develop a synthesis without destroying the rare and precious values of tribal life. How many among the political class, administrators, academicians, social workers and social activists, the non-native neighbors, have really imbibed such a humanistic spirit in their approach to tribal issues? The reality is just contrary to the spirit of idealism and optimism prevalent at the time of independence. Today, the tribal policies and approaches of the government of the post-independent India that the legislative and constitutional privileges extended to the native, instead of bringing about the kind of integration of the tribes, the national mainstream, within the Nehruvian framework, had only contributed to their systematic alienation at all levels, with possible exceptions. This is a reality not only confined to a few pockets, but throughout the length and breadth of the nation. A majority of the tribal people, having lost their traditional modes of existence, with no appropriate alternative strategies to substitute it, are at the receiving end, struggling to cope up with the realities. The approach cannot succeed unless there is an attitudinal change among all those who are associated with the tribal brethren. It is only in this context that it becomes necessary to evolve a realistic, appropriate, and humanistic approach that is most apt to the contemporary times, with an integrated perspective in the light of the experience of the past. First of all, it should be realized that not all the tribal people are at the same level of discontinuities, which necessitate categorizing the people possibly at three levels based on their self-preparedness to get integrated with the mainstream. The first group would comprise those who are at the adaptive stage, are potentially capable of encountering the outside society on their own strength. The second category would be those who had been at the receiving end from the mainstream and the maximum disadvantaged due to the onslaughts of modernity. Those who still possess something of their pristine past, and those who are still not much contaminated by the external influences and are confident of reviving their original culture, could be included in the third category, who could rightly be named as the eco-tribes. Since the problems of these different categories would entirely be different from one another, any kind of integrational efforts should essentially consider these realities. Based on the differential disposition of these categories, the problems of each group should be addressed differently. The problems of the first group may be addressed by ensuring their access to livelihood strategies at their will and facilitating them to enhance their social and economic capacity. The second group, who are in the thick of the transitional trauma, should receive the maximum healing touch and should be facilitated to maintain their collective life by ensuring their rights to their livelihood. The third group of people, the eco-tribes, should be allowed to maintain their distinctiveness along the lines of their own genius by rehabilitating them in the areas of the reserved forest and facilitating them to lead a natural way of life with full freedom and with minimum external intervention, while making use of their traditional knowledge in the efficient management and protection of the wildlife and natural forest resources. Secondly, it should be ensured that all those who deal with the affairs of the tribes are absolutely sensitive to the tribal way of life, and they have totally imbibed the Nehruvian principles concerning the natives. Such people should be extended with all support and adequate incentives and recognition to sustain their motivation. In this context, the Nehruvian principle of keeping the outsiders to its minimum, with the maximum incorporation of the natives themselves in the administration of their own areas, should be given due consideration. Furthermore, the government itself, along with the anthropologists, social scientists, service organizations, and other humanistic groups, should play a constructive and a proactive role by responding to the call of the time and become part of such initiatives towards the process of reconciliation and rehabilitation. By not only incorporating such concerns within the national policy on tribes, but also seeing to it that these are clearly reflected in any action programs that concern the tribes. According to the American anthropologist Melville J. Herskovitz, culture is the man-made part of the environment. It is positive and harmonious as long as it facilitates to explore and enjoy its resources within the confines of nature, as is the case with the pristine culture of the eco-tribes. However, culture has undergone a progressive evolution similar to the biological evolution. As biological diversity is necessary for the adaptation and survival of all species, cultural diversity also serves similar role for the human species as one of the most important mechanisms of adaptation. The concern should be how to construct sustainable ways of life while preserving cultural diversity within the confines of nature. The entire human culture had been molded in resonance with the nature's dictates and harmonious relationship. Never did the early humans surpass the forces of nature. This gets reflected in the various cultural institutions and the functioning of the tribal people. The human societies are said to have subsisted for almost 98% of its entire history, depending on nature and enjoying the generosity of nature. Before the human started to domesticate the plants and animals and develop agriculture and became pastoralists, even then, nature had not been subjected to so much of exploitation as it has been in the last few centuries, especially after the advent of industrialization, which account for only a brief period in the long history of humanity. It has taken a fraction of our long history to turn nature hostile to us in the process of our efforts to subject it under our control. The human intervention in changing the environment, in excess to our biological ability to adapt to the changes, has ended as a threat to the very survival of human beings in the planet. The exploding appetite for consumption and the wasteful patterns of resource use have together conspired to ensure that all segments of society are in the midst of one resource crunch or another, leading to serious ecological crisis. It has led to the depletion of natural resources, deforestation, and destruction of vast areas of land, erosion of soil, pollution of air, pollution of water, including the oceanic and groundwater, and of atmosphere, depletion of atmospheric ozone layer, destruction of Earth's green cover and plant diversity, and the consequent reduction of lower forms of life and extension of global warming. Such a degradation is attributed mainly to the change of man from part of nature to become an adversary of nature. While the realization has come very late, neither the process of destruction has been given a total halt, nor have the efforts to correct the approach dawned in the minds of every individual of the globe. It is time we turn our attention to learn and accept the limits of nature and adapt ourselves in tune with and become part of nature by understanding and appreciating the tribal perspective of ecoaesthetics. Thank you.
Thank you for that informative and a great lecture. So we can now open the floor for discussion and question and answers. So we can all type our questions in the chat box. So if you are present here, I'll just quickly unmute you and you can ask your question. So any comments, any points that you want to share, any ideas or any questions, please type it out in the chat box. Rakesh, would you want to start with a question? You can just start the discussion and then we'll get more and more.
Thank you so much, sir, for this wonderful lecture. Bringing multiple disciplinary into one platform where like nobody can think of aesthetics from this point of view, this many point of view, starting from the environment to culture to ecology to public rights to policy formation and all. So this is very, very thankful to you, sir, for this wonderful lecture. So like just to give a brief as a chairperson's duty, so I'll just give a brief that what sir has talked about. So sir, I started talking about this definition of aesthetics from this Western philosophical point of view, starting from Aristotle to Plato, and then he analyzed this Albanian view of the nature versus civilization. And then he talks, and in view, he talks about, he's bringing so many authors, starting from the Shakespeare's to Herbert Spencer's. And then he appreciated this Nairobian view of towards the indigenous people, and how should you incorporate the Nairobian civilization, or how we should view this like indigenous civilization or culture by appreciating their lifestyle tuned with nature and all. So in all this, sir, I have two connected questions with all these descriptions or description which you have presented. So one question is what has struck me, like when evolutionary theory says ki human evolution, people have started first searching for a habitat to look for which will suitable for the survival, and then he started appreciating this beauty or aesthetic beauty of this landscape. But when in terms of compare this landscape view in terms of habitat and in terms of this eco-aesthetics philosophically, because aesthetics always comes with this beauty, sublime notion of this beauty and all. So one, my point is that when we talk about this kind of relationship between ecology and this, then so ecology might not be very beautiful, but it might be very, very sustainable for these people who are living in that. So how do you think that when this ecological appreciation of aesthetics comes in this scenic or this picturesque view of the aesthetics? So this is one question. Another question is related to this isolation. Like when we try to this eco, when you talk about this model, the three model you have suggested to appreciate, that's when you form a policy for integrating tribal people into this society, or so you talk about this eco model, this eco tribe model. So in this eco tribe model, when we isolate the people from this, because when you isolate the people, beauty is always associated with this judgment of human judgment is always associated with the beauty. But when you isolate something from this judgment or approach to common human, then how can that place be so beautiful aesthetics, because it's not approachable for the many people in that term. So in this term, these two questions I have in my mind right now. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you, Rakesh. Rakesh is also Rakesh Kumar is also the chairperson of today's session. He is a doctoral scholar with Team CSP. I'll request Professor Gregory to please proceed with the answers.
Rakesh, your first question is tribal people living in the forest and having a sustainable way of living. And I mean, I'm not very clear about the first question. Can you repeat the first question, Rakesh?
Yeah, yes, sir. Sir, my first question was just that if, when we talk about this eco-aesthetics in broader term, so eco-aesthetic, basically it's a beauty, but many times when ecology is not very beautiful, but it's very suitable for the survival strategy for the people who are living in the forest.
Okay.
An exploration of this is how the exploration for this deep forest and has been started. So to search for this beauty. So what is your point on that? This is not just a question, this is my view. I want to know what is your view.
No, in fact, when we talk about eco-tribes, the people who are living in a forest environment, their entire life system is very closely in symbiotic relations with nature. Everything, they depend on nature, their economic life, their food, and their even religious performances, everything is related to nature. So they have a harmonious relationship with nature that makes their life beautiful, aesthetic. So in that way, it is also sustainable. So the conflict between nature and human beings comes when you over-exploit the natural resources that are available within. So the conflict becomes crucial when you are exploiting the nature and becoming making it unsustainable. So as long as you are within the confines of nature, you can really manage. And they have learned to adapt themselves to the eco-environment for centuries. But any problem they have been facing today is because of their outside contacts that had made them to suffer whatever the negative sides they experience today. The second question is with regard to isolation. I have clearly pointed out that there are three approaches which have been in the mainstream. One is isolationist approach, and the other one is assimilationist approach, and the third one is integration approach. In fact, isolationist approach was proposed before independence by Warrior Elvin himself because of the kind of suffering the tribal people had undergone due to the contacts with outsiders. So if at all anything, if the contact has to be smoother, it has to be very gradual. I mean, you cannot suddenly bring about a contact, and that is that leads to the exploitation by the outsiders of the tribal people. And that is the reason why very early in that particular context, he was advocating isolation. But after independence, mainly Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru clearly pointed out that what is required is integration, not assimilation. Assimilation is you give up your culture. You become part of another culture. But what Warrior Elvin meant was that you maintain your culture. It is beautiful. You maintain your culture and you still become part of the outside society, mainstream society. But it has not happened in the last seven decades of our independence. We have not really imbibed the spirit of Nehruvian principles. That is the problem. And so, in fact, tribes today do not represent a homogeneous group. As I said, they are at different levels of integration. So depending on the levels of integration, they need to be approached. Everyone need not get the same type of approach that is required. So there are people, especially in the middle stream, transitional stage, who really undergo a transitional trauma. So they need to be very sensitively approached. Whereas there is another group who have already become part of the mainstream and without any problem. So they have to be given a proper kind of sustainable livelihood schemes and so on. Whereas those people too still continue, very few people only still continue as eco-tribes. And that is their option. We cannot impose. If they want to come out of that forest and live in the mainstream, they have to be allowed. If they want to stay there, they have to be provided with a decent livelihood system, which is the support of government. And that is the kind of approaches we need to develop in regard to the tribes. Hope I'm clear.
Yeah, thank you, sir, so much.
Thank you for the answer, sir. I'll request Dr. Sinha to please proceed with this question. We can take the questions in the chat box.
Yeah, thank you very much, Professor Gregory.
Thank you.
It's very enlightening. And you know that I'm working with the communication anthropology and other dimensions of anthropology. So often, our people in the linguistics probably, now, because of their background, they talk about semiotics of the tribe, semiotics of culture. And my question to them or to everybody is that you cannot talk about the semiotics in ethic approach. You have to have an emic approach of analyzing the semiotics. And that can happen only if you follow the traditional anthropological research of ethnographic nature. Yes. So somehow or other, that's not happening. And we are responsible, probably, we the people in that academia.
Yeah.
And I have my own observation of the theory of isolation. 1994, something like 8 anthropologists from mainland were invited by Andaman Nicobar administration. We were taken to all the settlements, and fortunately we spent a couple of hours with the Zarbas in 1994. They were totally isolated from our culture.
Yeah.
And Kesi Malhotra, you know him, ISI, he was the chair of that our group, and we recommended very strongly that please don't disturb their life. Because unless we have a good plan for them, it's not wise to really disturb their own ecosystem. Although there is a very old debate of culture and development, development and change. But we felt, as an anthropological community, we felt that. And I can quote one good example by M. Sudhakar Rao. Sudhakar was just retired from Central University.
Hyderabad.
Sudhakar and Gurubi Reddy, under our project, they spent 5 years staying with Yanadi tribes of Sri Harikota. They really lived there, liked their lives, and then learn the dimensions of development that is required by the tribal, not to come in the mainstream, to be in a very good way, or what we say, aesthetic way of life. That's all I wanted to say. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Professor Arvind Singha. You have rightly observed that, I mean, that's what I pointed out. The eco tribes, there are very few eco tribes like Jarawas in Andaman, or in Kerala we have Cholanayakans or Enadis. So it is the decision, the choice is theirs, and we need to take the emic point of view, what the tribal people want, and exactly applying the anthropological methods and ethnographic research methods, and understand how and what kind of life they want. And that's what Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru was very clear about, the approach that nothing that should be imposed on the tribal people. It is for them to decide, but only we have to understand their aspirations and their difficulties and problems and address accordingly. Thank you very much, Professor Sinha, for your observation.
Thank you, sir. As we are running a little short of time, I'll just come to the questions in the chat box. Amrita, we'll just take a question after two questions from the chat box. I see your hand raised. So Mr. Praveen has asked a question. Sir, don't you think the efforts that man makes with any intention to save or to exploit the nature or tribal communities will most of the time lead to its disturbance or change the working fundamentals of nature? Is it not good to leave it undisturbed and not to bring our ideas of change?
In fact, the natural resources are to be used by human beings for our own welfare. But the problem comes when we exceed the limits of nature. And we have realized very clearly in the 1970s, 80s, we have been talking about sustainable livelihood system, where the nature has its own carrying capacity. Once you cross the carrying capacity, then you exploit nature. It's not that we should not make use of the natural resources, but we need to clearly understand where is the line, where is the boundary. And we cannot cross the boundary. And that is where we have to be very clear. And our way of life, in the name of civilization, in fact, we had gone too far to exploit nature. And we are experiencing the after effects of our own exploitation, including the COVID that we are experiencing today. So we need to put a clear cut boundary. And it's not that we should not make use of natural resources. We have to make use of natural resources, but we need to be aware of the boundary, the nature's limits, where we have to stop. Thank you.
Okay. I'll request I think Sakshi to please proceed with the question. Yeah.
Hello. Am I audible?
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay. Good evening, sir. It was a great session and it was very enlightening. So, sir, I had two questions actually. The first one being, isn't the isolationist approach a better one than an integrationist one? Because if we see in the current times, a lot of tribes are facing a lot of trouble because of whatever, like not even assimilation, but the integration they've undergone. So, and a lot of them are returning back to the jungle, or, you know, there are various programs which various tribes are taking around the world, such as move back to the land programs, etc. So isn't the isolationist approach better? And secondly, as you answered, sir, earlier, like, just right now, the second last question about the Jarwa tribes, that they should be deciding for themselves. But then another study shows that they have developed taste for bread, and recently they've developed a taste for clothing, which they have adopted from people who have been observing through the integration itself. So after developing the taste, they have it's been observed they are having various skin infections. So they are deciding for themselves, but is it right? I mean, is it appropriate?
Now, you know, in today's world, we cannot really keep a group of people separate. But then, See, integration is that you don't lose really anything that of your own. Your identity is kept intact and still you become part of it. When we talk about culture, culture is not static, it is dynamic. So it has to undergo change. But how it is changed, I mean, it should not be sudden. It has to be gradual change. So it is, if the people really they want to, I mean, the outside contacts today, the tribal communities that are having minimum outside contact are very few, like Jarawas and a few tribes. Most of the tribes are in contact. The problem is because of the contact, they have developed a lot of undesirable elements that have become part of their life. So that is the problem they are facing. That has to be addressed very seriously. And we have to really understand what their problem is. And they should not undergo any difficulties in the process of their integration. So integration is not assimilation. Assimilation is you lose your identity and you become part of the other. But integration is maintaining your identity. We all do that. We are all part of the maintained society. But we have our own way of life. Our way of life is different. Each one, community-wise, we have a different way of life. But we accept that and we are proud of it. Similarly, the tribal people, they should feel proud of their identity and become part of our mainstream. But if some tribes still want to continue to be, keeping away from the mainstream, we have to respect that. And we have to allow and provide all facilities to do that. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for the answer. We are running a little short of time. I'll request Amrita to ask her question. We'll proceed with Sukanya and Meera's question after that. So Amrita, if you can keep it a little quick and short.
Thank you, sir, for a very enlightening session. So my question is related to the based on the three approaches that you said, what would be your take on construction of museums and like especially the tribal museums and the artifacts that we place in the museums, like for the musical instruments or their dress, costumes, everything that we put as artifacts, aren't we like completely isolating from their own natural habitat and then placing it as a like the so-called aesthetic objects in a museum? So what will be the approach that you would proceed in terms of the museums and the objects that we objectify through those museums?
In fact, anthropological studies, what lessons we learn from the ethnographic literature? That we, I mean, in fact, Clyde Clacone would say that it is a mirror for man. When we study others, we see ourselves and we understand better ourselves, our culture. So when we take something and put it in the museum, it has its aesthetic dimensions. It has its own story to tell. And we have a lot to learn from that. I mean, when you put in the museum, it is for the tribal people that they have something good, that we respect and revere. And we want to learn. It is a cultural translation. Museum is a cultural translation. It's a translation of a life of a particular people to the outsiders to learn that they have such beautiful things that we learn and understand and respect. And that should create a kind of reverence to the tribal people. So museum, if they serve as something to teach us that the tribal people have their own best culture, their own identities, and we have to respect them, we have to understand them. That is the lesson we learn from the museum. So in that way, museum can serve something positive to the mainstream people to understand the tribal cultures.
Thank you, sir, for the answer. I'll request Sukanya to please proceed with the question.
Thank you, sir, for the wonderful presentation. Actually, I would like to know about the effect of culture when the tribal people used to do the displacement and rehabilitation. Especially when we look into the Wayanad Karda tribe in the Wayanad, after the displacement and rehabilitation, I think the culture changed a lot. So your viewpoints on that?
Yeah, it is a very unpleasant thing to displace the people. But for certain things, the government cannot but displace them due to certain macro kind of development. That's why today they cannot be easily displaced. Any program that is aimed at displacing the people, you need to undergo, get the sanction of environment impact assessment study is taken, social impact assessment study is taken, and economic impact. All types of studies are undertaken, and only when it is a last resort, they are displaced. And provided they are given a proper rehabilitation with all the kind of, in fact, you have to reproduce a similar kind of life that the tribal people have been doing in their original place. So that should be a last resort. It cannot be done very easily by any government today.
Thank you, sir. Since we have running a little short of time and we have did some of it, so I'll just take up one last question by Meera Kumar Menon. And I want to request everyone, the questions that you had, the two questions more I see in the chat box, they can be taken up in the WhatsApp group. Meera Kumar will be handling the WhatsApp group. She'll be opening the groups for 1 hour discussion. So please don't worry if you have some questions and you have missed in a Zoom session, you can take them up on the WhatsApp group also. I request Meera to ask the question.
Thank you, Niharika. And thank you, sir.
Sir,
my question is more related to policy making. I was wondering, when you were suggesting the integration approach, the very little experience I've had with tribal people, I've seen that there is usually a cultural gap between the material culture and the immaterial culture. For instance, the government might build toilets for the tribals, but then they would use it as storerooms because they are not used to having the toilets as part of their house, for instance. So when policy is being made, do we or should we ideally be focusing on material culture in the sense that we should we be providing them with all these amenities, facilities, like toilets, for instance, or whatever it may be? Or do we wait for the immaterial culture to catch up and then provide them with the materials that they might need? Which approach do you think is probably the best or better in terms of policy making?
You're right, Meera. When we provide something, before providing, we need to identify whether such a need is a felt need for the people. Many times what happens, we think what they require and we produce it, but they don't. It happened in, for example, Cholanaikans. You provided houses, but they don't come and live there. They go back. So what is the use? Or if you want to really construct houses, it is their felt need. You have to structure it in such a way that is adapted to their kind of culture. So for example, I think in Kerala government, they have been trying to understand what kind of houses would be congenial to the tribal way of life. I mean, each tribe may have different kinds of housing concept. So you got to understand that first before providing anything. And you have to see that whether it is a felt need of the people.
In that case,
this happened in, for example, in Kerala, in some districts, they have been using the toilet for storing. Even here it happened, it's happening. So because they have not owned the house. They don't feel at home with the house that is provided to them.
So thank you, sir, for the answer. As we are running a little short of time, I would like to conclude the session by giving my heartfelt thanks to Professor Gregory for taking up time to deliver a lecture today. So on behalf of Team CSP and Professor Sangeeta Menon, I thank you, sir, for the wonderful lecture that you gave today. So, and thank you all for joining us and making each Friday lecture a success. For the upcoming Friday, we have a linguist in the house. Her name is Devashri Trivedi. She'll be talking about decoding of the Wahi. She'll be talking about, record books in Gujarati. So stay tuned with us like each Friday, and we'll bring to you a new speaker and a new session. So thank you, everyone. Have a great evening. We'll see you on next Friday. Thank you.
Thank you very much.